Yes, hello, good morning also from my side. My name is Martin Hankel from Bosch Rexroth, and I'm working in the different committees from the platform industry 4.0, also in the ZVEE, and also in the IIC, for example, and with different Chinese committees in this moment. I want to give you an overview about industry 4.0. Hope it works, yes? I made a short introduction about the reference architecture model, Industry 4.0, only two slides that you have the income here in this session. Then some examples, where can you use in this reference architecture model? Some new things about product criteria, what we bring out now in the moment. And at the last thing, a comparison between the reference architecture from the US and the Chinese system architecture. If you look to the reference architecture model, Industry 4.0, you have seen it, I believe. We have three axes. The first axis is about the architecture. And if I want to make it very short, it is on the bottom you have the asset layer, and the asset layer is the real things what we have, like physics, for example, in the field. And then we have five layers above that. One is the integration layer. It's for the digitalization, so that all the assets can go up in the digital world here. And then you have four layers for the digital world, for communication, information, where are the data, the functions, and the business processes. The second axis is new here for such things. That's the product lifecycle. The product lifecycle is from the first idea over the development up to the production, sales, and then the service. So we want to have, for example, data on the information level layer here from the first idea, from the development up to the service department. We want to bring all the data together, for example, in this reference architecture model. And the third axis, very easy, is the old industry 3.0. Pyramid, what you most of the people are known here inside this thing. And we have put two things new. We have one thing new is the product itself. So the product who runs over the machines and will build up in the moment, that's the new thing what we bring in here in the RAMI model. And the other new thing is on the top, that's the internet, we call it connected world. If you have different factories, they have to communicate now in these new business fields, and that is also new in the industry for the 4.0 world here in the connected world. And for us, it's this RAMI model is the complete solution space, the complete solution space for industry 4.0, for smart manufacturing, and we use that for all our discussions in the moment what we have. Because each cube, you can see each cube here inside, for example, a data cube for the production area, in the control device area, here a cube inside, and you can discuss specific on this point for different standards, for different use cases where you can use it. The second thing what we have done is the Industry 4.0 component. That is a mapping of the RAMI to a real thing, to a product. And you see here, one thing could be a machine or a servo motor, for example, a thing. And each thing is now on the physical area and with the digitalization, with the integration layer on the administration shell, the digital world of the thing, with all the things what we have here inside the RAMI model, like the data, the functions, and also the business processes are inside this shell. And for us, in the future now, in the Industry 4.0 network, we need for each thing, we need an administration shell to bring these things in the Industry 4.0 network. That's the short introduction about our two things where we are discussing in the moment. How can I use that now? Some examples here. One example is the asset layer. In the beginning, I said, okay, physics is very clear. We have here product cables, metal sheets, all these things are physical things in the asset layer. But assets are a little bit more. Assets are also the software. All the software are assets. And also some general things like project plans, business plans, all these things I have also to bring in a process now as, or in a machine as an asset. And also the human beings. is that different roles also are assessed in the reference architecture model. And if we have the integration layer above that, then you see, for example, human beings over an HMI device, for example, have the digital connection by a smartphone, for example, have the digital connection here in the reference architecture model. They get values and they can give values back to the system. And on the other side, an integration layer is also integrated all the data of the processes. So we collect here all the data from the process, and then we decide which data we want to give in the Industry 4.0 network. And also the complete technology, the technical functions, directly near the process here in this model, and only the decision what we need in the Industry 4.0 environment we bring up to the higher layers. The next layer now is the communication layer. I believe the more interesting layer now for you here in the conference. And we had many discussions about this communication layer. It's only one layer. But after some discussions inside the platform, we decided to use also the OSI layer model for this one communication layer here. And we bring out some things here. We said, okay, we need a wired and wireless communication. Sure, we need that. We need Ethernet, for example, here. And we decided to say, okay, the basic for all communications inside the reference architecture model will be UDP IP or TCP IP, because it makes more easier to bring services now. If we have each communication allowed inside the reference architecture model, it's not so easy to, we will get problems with some services which we are defining in the moment. That's the status today, and for the future, we're talking about two new things which are coming up also this day with TSN, for example, is a good possibility in the future, but it's in the specification phase in the moment. We are not sure how can we use that in the future. We are in development in this moment, and also 5G is a good possibility, but it's a little bit far away as TSN in the moment, but it could be that 5G is also a good basic up to the transport layer. And then the big question was also, what is above that? What is about layer 5 to 7? What can we use there? And we have some discussions inside, and we are here on OPC UA conference, and you see, for this area here, we have decided to use OPC UA as the standard system, as the first system what we want to have in smart manufacturing here inside the communication layer. And you see that is from the product up to the work centers. That means complete automation lines inside a field, for example, we have UPC UA as a standard communication decided. Then you see two question marks. Sure. We are still in discussion in the moment. So what is above an automation line for a factory or for the connected world? Can we use such things too, or do we need a different communication asset here? It could be that it is AMQP, for example, that we have a REST architecture above OPC UA, but we are not decided in the moment. And on the other side, it's more the development part, where we have types in the development here. We need more exchange of different data, of data formats, of file formats. So that's not specific data where we have to exchange here. We have more files to share in this area, and it's also in discussion in the moment. But the good news for you here in the conference is UPC UA is the standard in this field. The next layer now is the information layer. The information layer above the communication layer is for data. Also very interesting for UPC UA, I believe. And we have different viewpoints for the data. I have one example here, one example for a servo motor. And you are, for example, you have a perspective of a supplier. So, for example, Bosch Rexroth built up servo motors. So we develop servo motors as a type, and then we produce thousands of servo motors as instances. And then we deliver them to machine builders. They included the servo motor in their machine, and the machine goes to an end user, and also the end user uses the same servo motor now in the field to produce new products. And if we look to the data here, the data over the time, we collect many data when we are develop and make a production of this motor. And we have also, by the building of the machine, we collect also some data. And the end user has also many of the data in his production phase for the same servo motor. And the main thing for us in the moment in Industry 4.0 is now we have to identify this one specific motor. That's important now, that to bring all the data together. That means we need a unique identification from the first beginning up to the end user in the field with the same identification on the motor, a worldwide unified identification here. And that's one of the points which we are discussing in the moment, what could be a good identification for all the things, for all the industry and smart manufacturing things, that we have one identification where you can find all the data, at least in a cloud or from the different servers here. And if we look a little bit deeper in this data, here's now the viewpoint from the supplier in the RAMI model. We are now in the lowest hierarchy here. It's a product. We build up a product over type and instance. And here are some of the data which could be bring out in this phase. So we start with a construction on the left side. We have in the production, we have quality data. We have the serial number for the identification here inside. And then we, if we get the motor back or from the field, we have also maintenance data from our side here as a supplier. So we have to collect many data as a supplier. And if we look, for example, to the end user, to the machine and then to the end user. The end user himself, he used the same servo motor now not as a product, he used it as a field device. Now it is a field device in his field, and he also collects data for the same servo motor now. He has location, he has inventory numbers, where is the motor here inside his plant, and then all the interesting field data coming up by the end user. About vibration, for example, of this motor, all the loads, what is on the motor, which all the people are interested in to have the possibility to bring up new business models, for example. Yes. And that's all the data, for example, which we are working in the moment. We have a special working group for electrical drives, and we're discussing these things in the moment with different drive suppliers where we can standardize these data. Worldwide standardization of these data, for example, to get all these things together and have new opportunities. That's what we want to do in Industry 4.0, new possibilities for new business. A new thing which we showed first time in Hannover are product criteria. What are product criteria? If you go over a fair, you see many suppliers. Everybody announced in the moment Industry 4.0. My product is Industry 4.0. My product is IoT ready. My product is something else in this case. Everybody has Industry 4.0 in the moment. But the customers, for example, do not know what is inside these products. You have no possibility to compare these products in the moment, and you are not sure what you get under this slogan. And on the other side, also the suppliers has the problem. We as Bosch Rexroth, for example, when we can bring out a label on a product for Industry 4.0 on a product, what are the criteria when we can give this label to our product? We have the same problem as the customers see in the market. That's why we are working together in the moment. We have a special working group now. For these product criteria for Industry 4.0, there are many people involved in the moment who are very good known in the standardization, what is possible, what we have here. And in the working group, we decided also to have it's a complete self-examination. So it is not a certification what you get here. At least you get an Excel sheet with some criteria. Is my product Industry 4.0 or not in this case? and it's free and for everyone, so everybody can use that to bring his own label on a product with some criteria which is coming from a commission which is independent from all the suppliers. And what is the structure now for these product criteria? The first one which we discussed is Industry 4.0 full. Full is everything. All specifications which are coming up in the moment, which we do not know, 5G for example, we are not sure what will be inside of that, that is Industry 4.0 full. That is also here above 5 years, could be 10 years when we have Industry 4.0 in the full range of that. That was the first thing that we said, okay, then we have the first frame. But the main interesting for me as supplier is not full. For me, interested is what is the minimum? What is the minimum? Is it 10% or 15% of Industry 4.0 full, which I have to fulfill with my products to be in the Industry 4.0 network? What is the minimum what I have to bring in? And that's for us Industry 4.0 ready, especially for the suppliers, give suppliers a hint what they have to implement in their components, in their products and systems here inside, that they have the minimum basis to be in the Industry 4.0 network inside. And we sit together with 25 suppliers in this range. We defined some criteria for that, and then we said, okay, there are not so much products in the moment in the market. Most of the companies announce Industry 4.0 in the moment, but we have not so much product which will fit in this area in the moment, because we are also in specification here, specification phases here. And then we created a third criteria. It's Industry 4.0 basic, and that's for today. That is that what the customer can buy today, in the moment, on the fair, or from the different suppliers. And we have also criteria for that, and we said, here are inside the products which are well prepared for Industry 4.0. Where we can say, for example, they have UPC Way inside, but we are not sure which protocol, which services you have to use, but you need UPC Way in your product, and then you are good prepared, for example. So the Industry 4.0 basic is in the moment for the product what we have today, and you see a small error here on the side over the years. So we want to have these, we make an update of these criteria each year, each autumn. We make an update of that, and then we see how the market is moving, which new technologies are coming up, which new services are possible, and then Industry 4.0 will migrate over the years in Industry 4.0 ready. And then we have ready and full as the two labels for our criteria here. And that's a very good system, I believe, and also the group believes, because we have a migration path from today. We can use it today, and we have a migration in the future if we have all the specifications ready for the Industry 4.0 network. And now you are interested about the criteria, I believe, and we took the RAMI model and also the Industry 4.0 component, and then we discussed what are the main differences between this Industry 3.0 and 4.0. Network. What are the main and definitions here in this case? One is the identification. I explained before, we need this unit identification on a product. The second one is the Industry 4.0 communication. The third thing is a semantics, Industry 4.0 semantics. The problem in the moment what we have is we want to bring different products from different suppliers together. And in this moment, these products have to talk the same language. If we talk here, for example, English, everybody can understand it. If somebody talks Chinese here in this moment, we will have a problem in this case. So we need the common language for Industry 4.0 with some vocabularies which are standardized. In this case with some syntax, and we are working on that in the moment, which are the basic informations which I have to give over these data structures. And then the highest level for us is standard functions. if there are some special functions which I can provide, which is completely independent from the supplier. For example, an easy condition monitoring. Easy condition monitoring features about how many cycles you have used in a hydraulic valve. You can have these functions for each of the valves, for each of the suppliers. Why not? And you get the same information of each of these products, and you have not to read a handbook. You see what you will have here. But this is a little bit more far away. We are working in the moment on these three things here as the first basis that we have that. And here we are in the first beginning. But the main thing for all is also, which we are working in the moment, is a different security level. So we need also security a little bit more what we have today in this component. So in each component will be, starting from the first sensor, security implemented with some information, with some data, with some parameters included. Those are the main criteria for us. The main criteria for us for Industry 4.0, and all these criteria you find also in the product criteria. And only for remembering here, UPC UA is one of the important roles here in the communication. And what we are working on in the moment is we will have an Excel sheet with these seven criteria for the different rows here, from basic, ready, and full. And we have this first suggestion in the moment in the working group, but we are not ready with the discussion because it has to fit. If we present a first one, this has to fit in the market here. And we said, okay, we take a little bit time, and in autumn this year at the IT Gipfel, IT Summit, we will present the process about the product criteria and the first Excel sheet also with the criteria for these three rows. And then the last one, also interested one, is that was Germany. What we are doing in the moment here for the reference architecture model, but what is about the others? The other interesting countries in the world. If we look to the US, US has the IIC, and the IIC has a different perspective. The IIC looks to the Internet of Things and Services. Internet of Things and Services is everything. It's smart mobility, smart grid, smart building, smart healthcare, all these things, and also smart manufacturing. It's one of the domains inside the Internet of Things and Services. And the IIC focus on the whole world. So they want overall communication over all these domains and exchange of data over all these domains. And in the Industry 4.0, we focus deeply here inside the industry. So we are only interested in manufacturing and smart manufacturing here in this case, and go a little bit more deeply in specifications here. That's the big difference at first. If you look to the reference architecture which they have bring out last year, in this case, and if you read that, you will find these viewpoints inside this reference architecture from the IIC, and it's more a specification for a software project what they are describing here. They have a very clear software focus inside this thing, and they started with key values from the business who will use at least these software package inside the company. Then comes a functional viewpoint, and then also some criteria for implementation, for real implementation inside the company. So a complete specification for a software and how to bring it into a company. That is the description what you have on the reference architecture from the IIC. And for us, what we are mentioned with Rami here is the functional viewpoint. That is the same level, for example, the same thinking what we have here. And there's a mapping, it's a clear mapping now also between these two architectures. And we have they have, for example, here in their architecture and the functional viewpoint, the physical things that match very good with our asset layer. The control layer here is match very good with our integration layer. They have also an information inside with our information layer, same data here inside. The function is divided into basic functions and also applications here, and the business is also the same. So we are quite near together in the same layer architecture with the IIC on a common view. What we have more, you see two question marks on the bottom. What we have more is the product lifecycle. It's not the focus of the IIC in the moment. They are discussing that in the moment. We know that very well. So they saw, okay, we have some differences, and they are talking in the moment to bring in also the product lifecycle in their system. And the hierarchy, what we have as a third axis, is not their focus. It's not the focus of the IIC in the moment, because the hierarchy, they need a hierarchy for each of the domains at least, for smart grids and for smart manufacturing could be that. And for all the other, for smart healthcare, for example, must be a different hierarchy. So this will be not the focus of the IIC. And we come together, and if you see the press releases, you have seen this picture, for example, coming out in March this year. And you see that's the cross-domain thing from the IIC over the different domains, and we have the deep dive here in the smart manufacturing area. And there's a small working group. If you see, we had the first meeting in Zurich, neutral ground in this field here. And the main thing for this first meeting was this was only technical people. Only technical people was on the table. Small group, 10 people there, and only technicians. It needs only 1 hour, and we was clear. After that, we had some suggestions how to go on the IIC and the RAMI modeled together, and it leads a little bit time over the political things. Then comes up the announcement that we can work together on an official way now, and we had made the second meeting now in Chicago by the IIC. And one main thing for me was that we have now a joint task group together with the IIC about reference architecture. Then we can meet together and talk about together how can merge the IIC architecture better with also the RAMI model. And the main thing for you here, I put it also on the slide, is something changed in the IIC, because until March, April, for example, in the connectivity group, there's a special connectivity group inside, there was only DDS and other things inside, and I saw now the first slide, whereas also UPCOA, especially for industry, now on a slide, and I hope in the next update, which is official, then you will get also this information that UPCOA is also included now in the IIC reference architecture. And the next big meeting is now done in September here in Germany. You are laughing. If I saw that the first time, I can read nothing, yes, but I saw it the first time, I was okay. Everything was okay for me, because I saw the cube, and then if we go a little bit deeper inside here, have a translation about that, what is on the cube on the side, you see that matches very, very well with our RAMI model here. We have some differences, sure. There's a little bit more interpretation on one or the other point in this case here. So there are some differences in the moment, but the first fit looks very well for me. So we are also here in discussion with the Chinese people. Go on, yes. The Chinese people themselves made themselves some mappings from their architecture to the RAMI model, make some suggestions, for example, how they can fit that in this case. So it's a good discussion in the moment about smart manufacturing reference architecture for China, which we are discussing here. And Mrs. Merkel signed a cooperation in July last year, and we had the first meeting in December in Shanghai with about 600 people was only presentations and nice to meet some people. I have many business cards which I cannot read, but was good to see each other, to see the main people. And then we had a second meeting in May this year here in Germany, and with a smaller group, only technical people now inside this group. And we also decided to make a task group for this system reference architecture, matching that with the RAMI model. And I believe we will have a good possibility to bring things together here. And here also the next meeting is in November this year. This was the information about international things like China or US. And if you need more information about the reference architecture model, we have new brochures, new things. We have the DIN spec now, the first standard here outside. We have new things since Hannover for interaction, for semantics here, or for communication. And we have also now some basic slides, and we have different videos to explain RAMI, also in English, all these things available to have more information. For my conclusion, what are the main topics which you have to take with you from my presentation? The first thing is the product criteria. I believe that will be a good step to make more clearance in the market. What is Industry 4.0 and what not? The second main point for me is RAMI will be the international smart manufacturing standard. I believe that. We are working on IEC in the moment, on ISO, on the different committees in the moment, and I believe it takes some time, sure, but at least we will have RAMI in all these standardizations. We have new materials. That was more critical from the last year. We need more descriptions about that, what we are doing in the different committees here in Germany. We have now many, many materials which you can look and where you can read things about our reference model. And for you, the first point, the fourth point, the main thing for you is UPCOA is on the communication layer, well established in this case, and you are here in the right conference for Industry 4.0. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hankel. Very impressive. I guess you have a lot of questions, but also me, so I'm starting because I have the microphone, right? So I have two questions. Right now, OPCUA is, let's say, just mentioned in the communication layer. Well, we appreciate, but just. And the modeling is on top of that. You also mentioned that you are now modeling as a first example a drive from Bosch Rexroth, for example, with others. So in what kind of language, modeling language, are you doing that? Because obviously OPCUA allows to take that whatever models in whatever description languages and integrate it into an OPCUA server for the modeling. This is one of the major benefits also of OPCUA beside the integrated security. So in which language are you modeling?
We have no decision in the moment about this language. We are only discussing in the moment the semantics, which are the datas which we need there in the moment. And we are not discussing tools or something like that in the moment. Yes. Okay. We have many companies inside the different committees coming from the IT side, which are not so familiar with UPCUA modeling. They want to have different things here in this case. But we are in discussion in the moment, what will be a good possibility.
That's why the IT company is here in the room to listen. And the second question, you mentioned, well, the three criteria levels, industry basic and ready and full. So what I learned is everybody who has a product which is OPCUA enabled would be in the category of industry 4.0 basic, right? So now everybody can put a second logo on his product, Industry 4.0 Basic. That, whom do we have to contact to get that logo?
The communication is one of the criteria, yes. We have at least seven criteria which we have to fulfill. So you need the unique identification, for example, on your products from the specification, like ISO 29005, for example.
Okay.
And if you fulfill all the seven, then you can put Industry 4.0 logo.
Hello, Joachim Steffens from Deutsche Telekom. You mentioned the administration shell as part of the RAMI model. I suppose this is one of the next specification items. The administration shell, to my understanding, shall expose some properties, capabilities of an object to the outside world. Similar approaches by OPC UA. So I ask myself whether there would be some more coherence between these two standards beyond just OPC UA using as communication layer. So are there some thoughts how to bring this closer together, administration shell and OPC UA, and are there already some implementation activities on the administration shell?
Mm-hmm. Mr. Heidel will have the next presentation here, especially on Industry 4.0 component and administration shell. To give a little bit more deep dive in these things. We have an open source project in the moment, OpenAIS, for the administration shell. So we give it to Consortia for open source here to create a first version, not only papers, now make a first implementation, a real implementation for the administration shell. And we have two architectures inside. One is UPC UA and one is the REST architecture. To test both of these possibilities. So we come nearer to a real implementation of the administration shell.
Okay, one last question. Oh, that's...
First of all, thanks for your presentation. My question is, you mentioned you as a supplier provide the information model or the data model. And you provide it to your machine builder and also to the end customer. What is your business model to say we provide this data? Do you stop or do you say we want to have a business model in behind?
I'm not clear if I understand everything. You mean the business model, what is behind the data from the server motor from a different level?
Exactly, to provide your data out of your devices.
That's in discussion in a moment. And it's not so easy to discuss, because if we are in a committee, it's not allowed to discuss business models. That's one of the things which we cannot discuss in a committee. But we are in discussion with different machine builders, for example. So we included also the machine builders in the working group now to discuss which data they can think about. What is you have not to provide all the data, you have only to provide a little bit of the data. For example, if we know the location of the motor from the end user, where is the motor in the world, that would be very helpful to see, okay, my servo motor is in Brasilia, there have to be a servo motor from us, and then I can provide service there in this field. So only a few data, if you look at that, only five or six data would be very, very helpful to help the end user and also the supplier or machine builder to get more communication together and start first business models which we can create of that. Yes. But it's not so easy to discuss, because everybody wants to make this business.
Okay, Ms. Hankel. Thank you very much. Very impressive presentation. Thank you very much to have you here.
Thank you.